morning, everyone. We are so glad to see all of you this morning. Teresa and I have been gone a couple of weeks. So glad to be back with all of you. Understand, Sherry and Dave did a great job. Everybody's been telling me how wonderful they were. They will not be back. No, just really. Big thank you, Janice. Thank you so much for Staff Parish has lined those speakers up. And just really love to hear that when we're gone, that you've enjoyed the services and enjoyed the speakers. So we're glad to be here. Hey, and a big thank you. I don't know how many of you know, but the pastor's office got an upgrade while I was gone. And so the door is open. Feel free to drop in there and look. And thank you to all of the people who helped in that project. That's been a big deal. There's been a lot of that going on. Yeah, just a whole bunch of people. Yeah, so I think they're listed in one of the, look at the screens, they're up there on the screens, so you can see that. Our gathering chorus this morning is number 328, Surely the Presence of the Lord is in this place. I invite us to stand together as we are able to join in our gathering chorus, number 328.
And good morning from me. It's good to see you all and good to be back. Good to see all of those that said they were coming back and they're here. That's great. This morning on the announcements, there are several, of course, in your order of worship. But please note that all of your opportunities to participate and to serve are on the screen. They are online and they are in your order of worship. So whatever medium is your medium, it's there for you. Please take note of all of your opportunities this week. If you have a candle in your house and you would like to light it, if you're online with us, you can participate in our lighting of the candles as Pastor Larry just did with us and take the light of Christ there with you. Would you join with me now in the call to worship? What's love got to do with it? And what does God have to say about love? Would you join with me now in the opening hymn, page 139? We'll sing verses 1, 4, and 5. And if you would please stand if you are able.
Jesus.
seated. Moving into our Seeking God's Guidance. And again, if you would join me in singing the chorus as we start, Bind Us Together. It is in this book at 2226, 2226. Bind Us Together. Teresa and I have been gone a couple of weeks, and we are really, really glad to be back with you this morning. We have been doing a lot of stuff in the last couple of weeks, and some of us have taken the opportunity to share with one another. We've done a little venting sometimes as a congregation and expressing ourselves, and you know what? That can kind of be good sometimes. Get some stuff said, get that off our chest, and move forward with that. But it doesn't help us solve our problems. Sometimes it might help us understand them. But it doesn't bring a solution to them, does it? To do that, we have to do what we've just sung about. We have to find ourselves binding together. And you know, the reality is this, that we are the church we are because we created us this way. And all of us are a part of that. And if we want to be something different, the good thing is we can create that too. Because that's what God calls us to be. And that's what God calls us to do. And so there's the good news in all of that. As we think about our futures, we think about moving forward. You know, sometimes our future is about doing something, and sometimes our future is about being something. And I think we're at a point where God is talking about us being something, and that takes us looking in, not out. And that's all of us looking in to ask ourselves, God, what do you want me to be in the future of our congregation, in the future of our community, in the future of your kingdom, and how does that work for all of us? We've been praying about our future for a long time, and our future is in God's hands, and that is probably the very best news we have. Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, you know what? You love us, and a lot of times, God, I don't understand that. But you do, and you care about us, and you love us in that way, Lord, sometimes we talk about. You love us just exactly the way we are, and then you love us too much to leave us that way because you're never done growing of us. I don't care if we're 90 years old. I don't care if we're 2 years old, God. You are in the business of growing us, making us, shaping us together as your community. We celebrate that. We welcome it. We embrace it, God, as we live in to your calling for our lives and for our church. We thank you, God. In your name we pray. Amen. I'd like to invite our prayer reader to come forward this morning to share our joys and concerns. And again, after each one, let us join together in the response, Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers.
Ray and Jenny Tolan also had a wonderful trip on the Mississippi River.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Rosina and Rector would like for us to keep Joyce Robinson Father in our prayers for dealing with health issues.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Jake Rillman would like us to keep Deb Payne in prayer. She's in Heron Hospital with three cracked bones in her lower back.
Lord, hear our prayers.
John and Etchen, keep Barney Moore in prayer. He made it through the colon resection just fine. He's home recovering, waiting on the reports.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Angie would like to thank the congregation for beautiful flowers for Administrative Assistance Day. It's a joy to serve, she says.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Don Massey would like to thank everyone for their prayers and calls and meals. Also, remember to keep his brother Ronnie in prayer. He still needs it.
Lord, hear our prayers. I know there are always other joys and concerns that are out there as well, and we lift those up this morning. I invite us to be in an attitude of prayer. I invite you to be in prayer in your pew, or feel free to come and join us at the altar this morning as we spend time in prayer. Dean will play a little bit of transition music, give you time to make your way up here if you'd like to come. Let's be in an attitude of prayer. Almighty and gracious God, it's good to be here this morning. It's good to be in your house this morning, God, and gathered with these people, Lord, as we come together, God, in one common element to worship you. That's our focus, God. We know, God, that you honor that by being here and being present. That's one of your promises, God. We celebrate that. And Lord, we are present here this morning. We pray that in our presence, God, that we'll open our hearts, open our lives, open our minds to you. That this morning, God, our worship can be a moment of being in your presence and of knowing that presence and feeling it touch our hearts and lives. God, there are a number of blessings that have been shared this morning, and we give you thanks and praise for them. You bless us with so many things, God, and we celebrate that. And Lord, there are concerns this morning as well. Concerns for those who have health concerns, concerns for those, Lord, who are going through seasons of grief and loss in their lives. Lord, we lift up those this morning that they would love to be here if they could, and they're just not able to do it. They're just not physically able, Lord. And God, we lift them up to you. And God, we just pray your blessing to be upon them. You know, Lord, we live in a broken world, and it touches our lives every day. But we also live in a world that you've created. And if we look, God, we see your presence in it all the time. This is the season of spring and so many things coming to life. And Lord, it just looks like resurrection all around us. We celebrate that. May the warmth of this day and the warmth of your spirit be a blessing to each and every one of us. God, hear our prayers as we raise them to you this morning. God, hear our prayer as we join together now, praying a prayer, Lord, that you have taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our second hymn this morning is hymn number 453, More Love to Thee, O Christ. And it's a little different, okay? We're singing verse 1, then we're singing verse 2, and then we're going back and singing verse 1 again, all right? So just, it is right in the thing here this morning. You may remain seated as we sing. Let us celebrate together this morning the giving of our tithes and offerings. The offering plate is just outside of the sanctuary in the vestibule back there. Would you bow your heads with me in prayer? Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks, not just for this day, Lord, but for the many blessings that you put into our lives each and every day. And you call us, Lord, to be good stewards of those blessings. They come in all kinds of different ways. Some of them, Lord, are the blessings of our body, and we pray for the blessings of health. But, Lord, there are other types as well. And some of those, Lord, are the gifts and graces that we have. And so, Lord, as we share them with your church, we ask your blessing upon them this day. Help us, Lord, to celebrate the giving of all that we have in one way or another into your service and into your church. In your name we pray. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is from 1 Corinthians, chapter 13, verses 1 through 3. In your pew Bibles, it is on page 1137 if you would like to follow along. Now I'm going to be reading from the New International Version. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and I can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Now this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
So when the superintendent said I was coming back for a fifth year, Teresa and I were glad about that. But one thing struck me really quick, and that is I've kind of run out of recyclable material. You know, so in retirement here, I'm doing what I honestly didn't want to. I'm kind of going into a season of everything's new. You know, so you're entering back into that pressure of you got a new sermon to do every week, a new sermon to do every week type of thing. So I was whining about that to my wife, and she said, well, I've got a couple of things I'd like for you to preach about. And so I said, okay, what you got? And she said, 1 Corinthians 13. You know, I'd love to hear a sermon series on that. So, hey, we're starting it today. This is it. We're going to move into it, okay? We're going to spend a little bit of time in this over the next several weeks. It's not really a verse-by-verse study. I've kind of broken it up a little differently and looking at it in a little different way, but we'll get started on that today. And hey, I've just got a few extra spaces in the year too, so if there's something you'd like to preach or to think about or to preach on, and no promises here, people, you know, but send me a text, send me an email, say, hey, you know, think about this, and I would be glad to consider that. However, if you tell me that as I'm walking out of the sanctuary, consider it forgotten by the time I get to the door, okay? But so send me something if you really would like for me to consider something. I'd be glad to do that. So we're looking at this letter and this particular chapter in the letter. As most of us know, this is the love chapter in the Bible, okay? And it is a profound teaching and really deserves the time and energy that we're going to spend on it because it's really a phenomenal writing. If you know, you talk about the inspired word of God, this is an inspired word. I mean, it's just kind of beyond the ability of people just kind of to write this and put this together. It's really an amazing text. But if we're going to understand it, you really need to understand Paul's letters to the church. And so I'm just going to challenge you over the next few weeks, read 1 and 2 Corinthians. They're an interesting read. You know, it's fascinating material, and it's, you know, honestly, they're no longer than a long article in a magazine. They're not long things, but they're thick in terms of they've got a lot of stuff that Paul is writing and talking about. So I encourage you to do that. If you can't do all of that, read through 1 Corinthians 13 a few times and just kind of get familiar with what we're looking at and where we're going. But to understand Paul's letters, you need to understand a little bit about Corinth and what was Corinth. Corinth had been a city in Greece for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. But it was destroyed in a conquest of Greece, and then the Romans rebuilt it later because it is on a really important piece of real estate. So I don't know how much you know. Our kids moved to Madison 3 years ago, or not quite 3 years ago, and Madison, the town, is built on an isthmus, okay? Now, that puts you back, doesn't it? That elementary geography, isthmus, what's that word? I can't spell it, but I can say it. And an isthmus is just a small section of ground between two bodies of water. So in Madison, it's two big lakes, and then you've got this little narrow strip of property, this little narrow strip of ground, and that's where Madison started. It was right there. Corinth is very similar to that, except it's much larger in scope. So you've got Upper Greece that is attached to the European continent. And then you've got Lower Greece, which is almost an island. But it's fairly large, a lot of major cities in Lower Greece. And there is an isthmus between them. It's about 4 miles wide and, I don't know, 9-10 miles long, something like that. And that's where Corinth was. So everybody who went from northern Greece to southern Greece or southern Greece to northern Greece had to walk the isthmus unless you took some kind of a boat across the little bodies of water around that. But one of the other things about it, and in this time, and we're talking 55 AD is about the time of these letters and when Paul's working with this stuff. So, you know, we're into that a little ways. But at that time, sailing around the bottom of Greece, the southern part of Greece, was considered really dangerous. I don't know what it was, but the Mediterranean was not friendly there. And so a lot of people who shipped and cargoes and were doing commerce and merchants, they would sail into the isthmus on one side, and then they would either drag their boats across the isthmus, it was 4 miles, or they would unload the cargo and load it into another one to avoid the 200-mile-plus journey around the inn, which was really dangerous. So then not only was it a major land route between two major populations, but it was also a major port because all of these ships came in there to get their merchants and their cargo across safely rather than going around the southern part of Greece. That's what was going on in Paul's day, in Paul's time. Large city, thousands and thousands and thousands of people from all over the world, every language, every color, all there in Corinth. One of the other things about Corinth was when you get a lot of people together like that from all over the world, there's all kinds of cultures, all kinds of things that are going on in that. One of the biggest things going on in Corinth was the temple of Aphrodite. That was in Corinth. Now, if you don't know, she is the Greek goddess of love. And so there was a rather long-running established business that ran out of that temple. And at its peak, there were about 1,000 prostitutes who were there and present in that. And in the evening, they would come down into the city and conduct their business. So it was a place. Really, we don't have a city like that anymore. We don't have a city that has that kind of stuff in it. I mean, it's not that there was slavery and freedom, but there was that going on. There was a lot of other things going on. And it was considered to be the vilest city in the world at that time. You could go to Corinth and get, do, have whatever you wanted. It was all there. Now, if I'm starting a church, I'm probably not going to Corinth. But I'm not Paul. And Paul saw Corinth as an excellent place to share the good news of Jesus Christ. And if you read his letters and know a little bit about his life, the only place Paul spent more time after he became a Christian and began his ministry of sharing the gospel around the world was Ephesus. But the next longest stay for Paul was at Corinth. On more than one occasion, he visited there and worked with there. Now, if you want a resource to really understand the letters, I'm using this, William Barclay's Commentary on the New Testament. Now you say, I'm not a commentary reader. It's not like that. This is actually called the New Daily Study Bible. He writes it as a daily devotional, and you can actually read it that way. And so if you really want to get into understanding Paul's letters and what was going on in Corinth, wonderful book in order for you to pick up and use in terms of looking at that. So Paul is working with these Christians there, and the church at Corinth is an expression of the city in so many ways. It has people of every flavor, every variety there worshiping in the house churches because there wasn't like a church. And so Christianity at this time, it's not like us. It's hard to imagine it. They don't have traditions. They don't have customs. They don't have orders of worship. They don't have, you know, they don't have the things we use in terms of being able to worship. Christianity is just understanding itself. It's just forming itself. Paul is writing, literally writing the theology of the church in these letters to all of these places. So everything is radically different. One section from another, one church from another, the things that are going on. But it's interesting reading if you read the issues that Paul's writing about. He hears about troubles going on, so he writes a letter and it gets worse. Finally, he shows up and tries to get things together. So that's the atmosphere that Paul's writing in. The church is separated and divided by a whole bunch of different things. Some of the people say, I follow Apollos. Some of them, I follow the Apostle Paul. Some of them, I follow Jesus. But the other issue is there are all these spiritual gifts that they're experimenting with and trying to understand. And so Paul begins this chapter with a focus on spiritual gifts. And he talks about five of them. He talks about tongues. He talks about prophecy. He talks about intelligence. He talks about faith. And he talks about charity. All of these were gifts in the early church that they were exploring. So let's look at the first one for a moment. Tongues. Okay. So who's been to a Pentecostal service and heard someone speak in tongues? Hey, there you go. Yeah, me, I've been there several times, been a part of that. My oldest grandson, Alex, went to a church camp last year with a youth group that he was working in and participating in, and didn't know that he was going to a full gospel church camp. Got down there, and pretty quickly, the worship service that night, the kids were speaking in tongues, they were being slain in the spirit, and he was like, what am I, where is this? I thought I was on earth, you know. And an older counselor got with him and said, hey, you know what? These kids are brought up this way. That's the expectations they have. You know, it's not a part of your, I get that. He says, some of it's authentic, a lot of it's not, but you'll kind of sort through that. So he got a little more comfortable with it. But if you've ever been there, and I've been in those services where somebody speaks in tongues, and then sometimes I've been there and somebody interprets that and they share what they've just said in terms of that. Now, it's not a language. So it's not like on the day of Pentecost. You remember Acts 2, the day of Pentecost, and the Spirit comes down on the people like little flames in their heads, and they speak languages that they've never spoken before. So it's a miracle, but it's not speaking in tongues like Paul's writing about. Because what he's writing about is someone who stands up and says something. They make noises or they use things that could be considered maybe words, but nobody understands what it is. But it was a spiritual gift. And it still is today a spiritual gift. And you see it around. Now, some of you have been here a long time worshiping in this congregation. And I'm going to bet if I ask the question, has anybody ever spoken in tongues during the worship service in this church? The answer is no. You say, why is that? Why is that spiritual gift never here in this church? Well, it's primarily because we don't celebrate it. We don't emphasize it. And other churches do. And when you emphasize that and you focus on it and you make it important in the life of your congregation, it becomes an expectation and people respond to that. Now, there may be people here who have that gift this morning, but we don't know that. Maybe they don't know that because they repress it. It's like, that's not what we do here. That's not a part of our worship. That's not a part of our celebration. We don't celebrate that as a congregation. It doesn't make us good. It doesn't make us bad. It just makes us who we are. You have people who might attend a Pentecostal church where that's an expectation. And if they don't have that gift, they probably go someplace else to worship, because what happened in the early church is what happens almost everywhere that gift is used, is it becomes kind of a rite of passage. It is the objective truth that the Holy Spirit has come upon you and filled you. And so you speak in tongues. And so it becomes a, hey, I speak in tongues. I'm filled with the Spirit. You don't. And so suddenly there's a class thing here. This is better. This is worse. And so Paul's speaking to that because it became a source of separation in the early church. I have the gift of tongues. You don't have the gift of tongues. And that was seen as a positive. So people were seen as more important if they had that, or they thought of themselves as more important. What Paul emphasizes is the second gift he talks about, the gift of prophecy, which is people who get a word from the Lord and they share it in the group. It's meant to be shared in the group. And that happens with us sometimes. Sometimes we're praying about something or we're working on something. Does anybody have a sense of that? Does anybody feel the Spirit leading them or guiding them or speaking to them about it? And some people say, yeah, you know, I feel this, I feel that. And they share that with the group. So we experience that from time to time. And Paul emphasized that gift as being very important. The Lord speaks to you. Sometimes that's an individual word God gives to you. Sometimes that word is for everyone, and you need to share it with them. And it edifies the community when you do that and work with that. The other thing he talks about is intelligence. And though I had the intelligence to understand all mystery and all knowledge, in Paul's church in Corinth, there were people who were illiterate. They had no educational training whatsoever, probably a lot of them. They couldn't write, they couldn't read. They didn't have any training like that. In our church, we print a bulletin on Sunday morning, we hand it to everybody with the expectation that you can read it, that you know how to read and write. We have a standard educational process. Many of us are fairly highly educated in that. It wasn't like that in Corinth. You had people who had no education at all, and then you had people who had education and educational training. People who might even be assumed to have had advanced educational training. Well, what happened? Well, it became a source of separation in the church. I'm smart. I have educational training. I have educational knowledge, and you don't. And the people with it looked down on the people who didn't have it. It didn't mean they weren't just as smart, because a lot of times, if you work in that world at all, you know there are people who are illiterate who are very intelligent. They just never had the opportunity. But it became an issue in the church because intelligence was valued, and those who didn't have it were considered to be lower. And then you get faith. Faith is something we all have. But in the early church, one of the ways faith was expressed was in those who could help with miracles. Miracles were maybe a more frequent part of the early church, or at least they assumed it that way. People were healed. I've held healing services as a pastor. According to the model of the New Testament, you gather some of the elders of the church together, you anoint someone with oil, and you pray over them. And I think there are people who are miraculously healed in our day and time by a variety of different circumstances. That was true in the early church. Sometimes people got known as that gift of healing or that gift of faith that allowed for unusual things to happen in their presence, that they were gifted in that way. And so the gift of faith was a part of what they talked about. Paul says, if I had the gift of faith as to remove mountains, but didn't have love. And the last was charity. Now, this is probably the one that we struggle with the most in terms of trying to understand exactly what Paul meant by that. Because he said, if I give all my possessions to the poor. So what that would be is you, me, putting everything we have up for sale. Selling everything we have. Taking all that money and giving it to Compassion Ministries or giving it to the Salvation Army or giving it to some group that works with the poor. And then we go off and live maybe in a monastery or a convent and serve out the rest of our lives that way. That's not really a tradition for us. But right across the street, it is. When a priest becomes ordained, they take a vow of poverty, that I'm not going to invest in worldly possessions. I think it's true for nuns as well. They take a vow of poverty. And so, while it's not a part of our tradition, there are still traditions where that happens. So it is like Mother Teresa. It's like, you know what? I'm not going to own anything myself. I'm giving everything I have to the poor, and I'm giving my life completely in the service of God. And I will live off the generosity of the church, whatever they provide, and I will be content with that. So it's a big ask, and it's a big give, is what he's talking about here. He goes on to say, and give my body to be burned. And that's, we don't really understand fully what he meant by that. There really wasn't that practice, even in the area very often and historically. Some evidence of that, but not much. So I think it's just a sacrificial statement around, you know, even if I gave my life in terms of that. And to all of these, Paul ends exactly the same way. If I have the gift of tongues, if I have the gift of prophecy, if I have the gift of intelligence, if I have the gift of faith, if I have the gift of charity, but you do not have love, that gift is meaningless. That gift is worthless. What Paul did in this letter and in this chapter was define something for the church which has stood for over 2,000 years. Paul here sets love to be the defining characteristic of the Christian faith. And in this letter, and while we don't talk about it sometimes, he makes that the priority of Christianity. It is the center focus of God, but Paul makes it the center focus of the Christian church. He sets this up and simply says, you know what? Everything else comes second. Love comes first. And then Paul goes on to define it, and we'll start picking up on that over the next few weeks. We'll talk about what love is and what love isn't. But part of what we struggle with in our world and in our faith is that, and they did too, we do too, different is very seldom equal. Different is always better or worse. It's just kind of a thing we do. And we don't mean it, you know, but honestly, how many times is different just perfectly equal to you? Yeah, they're a little different than us, and that's okay. Yeah, that's okay, but it's not quite as good. You know, we're just like that. We can't help it. And so the early Christians were like that too. And Paul is trying to let us look at this in a way that if you want to hold whatever gift you bring to the church up against something, hold it up against love. Because that's the number one calling of our lives. And that's more important than all of the rest of it. And I don't care how gifted you are. I don't care how talented you are. I don't care how much you give. I don't care how much you serve. What Paul is saying, if you don't learn to love, it doesn't make a difference. Because that's what we have to do first. And that's what we have to do most. And today, that focus in our church and in the Christian movement is because of this letter and because of this chapter. Paul lifts that up and says, that's first. Get that one down first. And then let's work on the others. Would you pray with me? Almighty and gracious God, it is hard for us to grasp what Paul is talking about here this morning and the fullness of what he's talking about. That all these things that we think are so important and that we value and that we cherish, and Paul says none of them are as important as love. Help us, Lord, to open our hearts to that and to understand it, and to bring it into ourselves that we might be shaped and formed by it. Speak it into the life of your church, God universal, and into the world in which we live. Lord, help us to see and understand this calling upon our lives. And God, we just ask this all in your holy name. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 348, Softly and Tenderly, Jesus is Calling. We're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 4. I invite us to stand as we are able for number 348.
Thank you.
Just to remind everybody, I think at 11 o'clock today, we're having our social potluck, so you're all welcome to attend that. Would you bow your heads with me in prayer? Gracious and loving God, it's good to be here this morning. Thank you for being present with us, providing your Spirit for our hearts and our lives. Lord, help us to be your people and your church. We thank you, God, for this amazing gift of love and what it means to our lives and to our world, and I can't even imagine a world without it, God. Help us to know it. Help us to live it. Help us to be it. God, send us forth from this place out into the world as people who hear that calling upon their lives, that's first and foremost. Help us to be that people in the world, that we might be your light and your salt and your yeast. We ask this, Lord, in your holy name. Amen. Folks, have a great week this week.